Hello everyone. Discussing about the power system stability, in this session we are going to see how to derive the swing equation. Derivation of swing equation will help us in understanding if the power system network is going to be stable after the disturbance or not. For deriving the swing equation, we take into consideration certain assumptions. So we consider the classical model of the machine, we don't consider the effect of controllers, and we assume the loads to be constant, which is not going to be a constant in real time, and we are assuming the voltages and currents to be sinusoidal and the damping to be neglected. So let us consider the generator and motor model, a synchronous machine model. So when we talk about a motor, so motor is given electrical energy, right? So according to the electrical power that you give to drive the motor, you have an electrical torque being generated, electromagnetic torque. In few books they mention TE as the electromagnetic torque, and in few books they also give it as the electrical torque. So TE is the electrical torque, and corresponding to that TE you will have a rotation, which is omega. So your rotor is going to rotate, and let omega r be the rotating speed of the rotor, or the rotor's angular velocity. So rotor angular velocity. And opposite to this electrical torque, we always have one more torque, which is the mechanical torque. So that's with a motor. And similarly, when we talk about the generator, we are going to take out electrical energy. How do we take out electrical energy? By giving some mechanical power. So mechanical power in the from the turbine is going to drive our machine. So it is driving this machine, synchronous machine. So you have a mechanical torque, and corresponding to this mechanical torque, you have a speed of rotation or angular velocity in your machine, and you have a torque, electrical torque being generated, and an electromagnetic torque. Okay, so you have two torques, right? One is the mechanical torque and other is the electrical torque. And we often have a question of is there only two torques in a machine? No, actually we have more torques in a machine. Like you have friction, due to the friction and windage you have one more torque, and that's neglected most of the time. And also you have one more torque TB, which is the damping torque. And always we will be taking into consideration the worst case, right? So under worst case, we will say that the machine does not have a damping torque at all. And that's how we will be proceeding with our derivation. So here, I am going to say that we have two torques. One is the electromagnetic torque and the other is the mechanical torque. So these torques put together, you have the total torque, which is TA, and this TA is the accelerating torque or it is also known as the torque due to inertia or inertia torque. So here, as I said, we are going to consider the worst case, that is we are going to assume the damping torque to be zero. Every machine which has a mass associated with it will have a damping, but we are going to neglect this damping for the sake of mathematical modeling. Okay, so we are going to consider the worst case scenario and we are going to do the derivation. So you have the accelerating torque, which is equal to the mechanical torque and minus the electrical torque, right? We being electrical engineers, we are not comfortable with handling all these torques, and hence let me multiply both the sides by the rotor speed, which is omega r. So let me multiply this expression with omega r into TA is equal to omega r into TM minus omega r into TE. So after multiplying both the sides with omega r, we know omega t is nothing but power, right? So here you have accelerating power, and then here you have the mechanical power, and this is said to be the electrical power. So PA is equal to PM minus PE, where PA is the accelerating power, PM is mechanical power, and PE is the electrical power. And we know TA is the torque due to inertia, right? So I could write TA to be equal to moment of inertia into acceleration alpha. So J is moment of inertia and alpha is the acceleration. Now in place of TA, let me substitute J alpha. So here, so this is one equation. Let me highlight this equation and name it as equation number one. And apart from that, now you're going to take into consideration this equation where we will be substituting in place of TA J alpha. Omega r is equal to omega r into Tm, or you could just write PA is equal to accelerating power is equal to omega times TA. So omega times TA in place of TA, I'm substituting J into alpha. Now let me rearrange this. I'm writing it as J omega r into alpha, and this J omega r, moment of inertia into the speed, angular velocity, is written as angular momentum. So I could write PA also as m into alpha, where m is the angular momentum. Now let us consider the classical model. So this is the classical model that has to be considered. So you have the classical model, and according to the classical model, you'll be talking about rotor. So rotor is a salient pole rotor, and the rotor has a direct axis and a quadrature axis. This direct axis is making an angle with regard to the reference. Okay, so here I consider the stator's magnetic field as reference. Now let me consider a stationary reference. So let me consider the salient pole of the rotor, and let me again redraw this. So you have the stationary rotor, the rotor which is rotating. Okay, so here your rotor is rotating with the speed omega r, and you also have the stator's field here. So that's omega s. And apart from this, we have one more person who is going to act as a stationary reference. Okay, so let this be the stationary reference. Okay, so this is my stationary reference. So with respect to the stationary reference, my rotor is making an angle theta. Okay, and with reference to the stator magnetic field, my rotor axis is making an angle delta. So when you write the expression of theta, we write it as, so here we don't know the value of angle, right? So if we don't know the angle of angle here, you could say that here in between the stationary reference and the stator's magnetic field axis, you say you have an angle of omega s into t. So omega s into t is going to be equal to the angle. So we write theta as, so theta is written as, so theta is written as omega s into t plus delta. So omega s into t plus delta is going to be the angle theta, where theta is the angle of the rotor with reference to the stationary reference. So now here you have an expression for the angle, and let me differentiate this angle once. So d theta by dt is equal to omega s plus d delta by dt. And again, let me take a second order differentiation. Okay, so when I go for a second order differentiation, you have d square theta by dt square is equal to omega s on differentiating, that being a number constant, it becomes zero, plus you have d square delta by dt square. So I could write d square delta by dt square to be equal to d square delta by dt square. So we might have a question in mind, why have I differentiated this expression? Because I have differentiated this expression because here you have alpha. So what is alpha? Alpha is acceleration, and acceleration here, the rotor is accelerating. So rotor is accelerating in the sense the angle is changing. So the second order derivative over time, that is d square by dt square theta, is the acceleration. So here this is nothing but alpha. So in place of alpha, we are going to substitute d square delta by dt square. So the expression that we earlier have is pa is equal to m into d square. So m into alpha, in the place of alpha, we are going to substitute this expression. So it is m into, in place of alpha, we substitute d square delta by dt square. In general terms, we could say that this is the swing equation, but we are going to dig deeper into this equation. So in place of pa, I could write pm minus pe is equal to m d square delta by dt square. So this could be considered as the swing equation. So let me name this equation as number 3. Generally, we have neglected damping, right? So if we are going to consider damping, then the swing equation would be Pm minus Pe to be equal to m into d square delta by dt square. Accommodating the damping concept, you have d into d delta by dt. And this is beyond the scope of the undergraduate syllabus. So I just consider equation which is named as number 3 to be the swing equation. So let me talk more about the term m. So m, as I said earlier, m is the angular momentum. And at synchronous speed, we could call m as the inertia constant. And now, so m is written as j into omega s. So at synchronous speed, so it is j into omega s. So you have inertia constant as h. And this inertia constant, per unit inertia constant, so that's equal to the stored kinetic energy at synchronous speed, divided by the machine rating. So you want to have it in per unit, right? So you divide it by the machine's rating. Our machine is an AC machine, right? So AC machine, in the sense you have power to be complex power. The rated machine is not rated power is nothing but the base power. So machine rating is SB. So let me now substitute the value of kinetic energy that is stored. So it is half J omega S at synchronous speed, right? So in place of omega, I substitute omega S square divided by rating of the machine SB. And now let us cross multiply. So you have H is equal to half J omega S square divided by SB, right? So let me write this half. Okay, so 2, which was in the denominator, is taken to the denominator as such. And now let me cross multiply the expression and bring it to the form J into omega S. So let me retain J into omega S and cross multiply all other terms to the other side. So I'll have J into omega S is equal to 2HSB divided by omega S. And we know J omega S is equal to M. So here M, in other words, could be written as 2HSB divided by omega S. Equation number 4. And now I had a form of swing equation labeled as equation number 3, right? So now let me substitute the value of M here in equation number 3. So substituting equation number 4 in 3. So you have Pm minus Pe to be equal to, in place of M, you are going to substitute 2HSB divided by omega S into d square delta by dt square. And now, if you see here, you have your power rated in watts, right? Always in power system analysis, we have all calculations referred to per unit values. So if you want to convert per unit, a watt into per unit, then you have to divide watt by the rated MVA. And the rated MVA is nothing but the machine's base power, which is labeled here as SB. So now let me cross multiply. Okay, so let me bring this SB to the other side, cross multiply. And I'll have PM divided by SB minus PE divided by SB is equal to 2H divided by omega S d square delta by dt square. And here, now your powers are getting converted into its equivalent per unit values. So PM in per unit minus PE in per unit is equal to 2H, and omega S is synchronous speed, right? So synchronous speed omega S is equal to 2 pi F. So substituting 2 pi F d square delta by dt square, substituting 2 pi F, you could see here 2 and 2 could be cancelled. And finally, you write the expression as Pm minus Pe is equal to H by pi F d square delta by dt square. So generally, we have all the values in per unit, and hence everywhere you don't have a subscript mentioned as PU. Okay, so generally we'll not find the subscript, okay, anywhere in the textbooks. And PM, PE itself means that those are the equivalent per unit values. And let us see how you could define the swing equation. So if you are asked to define the swing equation, so point number one, if you look at this equation is a second order differential equation. And what does this equation define? So delta is going to define the position of your rotor. So if you look at the classical machine model, you could see delta is referred as the angle that is between the stationary magnetic field and the rotating magnetic field. So here you have the angle delta. So delta is the angle between the stationary axis and the rotating axis. So swing equation is a differential equation. Swing equation is a differential equation which defines the relative motion of the rotor, relative motion of the rotor with respect to, or the position of rotor with respect to the stator. So with respect to the stator as a function of time. So here you have the derivative with respect to time, right? So swing equation is a differential equation which defines the relative position or a relative motion of a rotor with respect to the stator as a function of time. And the plot of delta with respect to time is known as the swing curve. So when you talk about a swing curve, you have two possibilities. So taking delta along the y-axis and time along the x-axis, there are two possibilities. So your power system is operating at an initial rotor angle delta naught, and in case if you have a disturbance, the rotor angle could vary, okay? So that could increase following a disturbance, and as time progresses, so your transients might damp out and you could go to a new stable position. So new rotor angle delta 1 or delta dash. So this is the new delta value after the disturbance, following a disturbance. And under worst case, if you don't have proper damping, then your delta might continue to increase, okay? And such a response is known as an unstable response, or your system is going to become unstable under this condition, okay? So looking at the plot of delta, we could say whether our system is stable or not, and that's the significance of the swing equation. And let's consider two cases now, and let's see that in detail. So case one is when PM is greater than PE. That is, if you're going to consider a generator, so you're going to give more amount of power from the turbine, okay, than what is being produced. So under this case, what is going to happen with the machine? So PM minus PE. So PM is greater than PE, and hence PM minus PE is the accelerating power, right? So PM minus PE, accelerating power, is going to take a positive value, and hence, so the left hand side of your equation is positive. K by pi F is always a constant, right? So d square delta by dt square. So what is this? Acceleration. So this term is acceleration. So you're going to have a positive acceleration. So your machine is going to rotate fast. And case two, what happens if your mechanical input, whatever mechanical input you feed, is less than the electrical output which is being generated by the machine? So you don't have sufficient mechanical input now here, right? So under this case, your PM is going to be less than PE, and hence, so here the difference is going to be negative. That is, d square delta by dt square, the acceleration is going to take a negative value. The other way The other counterpart of acceleration is termed as deceleration, where your machine is going to slow down. So under the first case, your machine speed is going to increase with time, and during the second case, the machine is going to slow down, that is your speed is going to decrease with respect to time. And under steady state, the case, third case, under steady state, so when you're going to talk about the steady state, the accelerating torque is going to be zero, that is your mechanical torque is going to be equal to the electromagnetic torque or the electrical torque, and hence the accelerating torque is zero. Here again, you could have the discussion in terms of torque, and then you could discuss in terms of power. So here you don't have any accelerating power, and under steady state your acceleration is equal to zero, that is machine is going to run at constant speed. So looking at the swing equation, we understand how whether your system is going to be stable or not, and also we could understand that if my system speed is going to increase, decrease, or whether it is going to be maintained constant. So all these could be inferred from this swing equation, and the swing curve serves as an effective tool to decide if my system is going to be stable or not. Thank you.